Hi there, I'm Christian and you're watching A Dev Story. This is the second video of the Software Architecture series where I'm covering core concepts in a practical way. If you haven't, check out my other video first. Just recapping from the previous video, we are building an e-commerce site and we have a basic layer architecture in place. So at the time we started with the layer architecture because we are covering the maintainability aspect of the software. With that architecture, we are also able to deliver the functional requirements that we need. Now it comes to mind the question, will it scale? And we need to define what is exactly what we need to scale. Do we need to scale the number of concurrent requests that we can handle? Or do we need to scale the amount of data that we are handling? So let's assume both. In the previous architecture, let's assume that we have all of this in one server. So if we want to handle 100 users concurrently, that's fine. We can support it. 1,000 users, probably fine. 50K users, let's check. But probably we need to add more hardware. In this case, this is called a scale-up or vertical scaling. Vertical scaling basically means to make the nodes stronger, right? Like if you have one server, make the server stronger, faster, adding more hardware, basically. Make optimizations on the software that would allow it to process more requests with the same number of resources in one server. Now let's say we want to handle 10 million users at the same time. In this case, probably only having one server won't be enough. So in this case, we need to do horizontal scaling or scaling out. Horizontal scaling basically means splitting the load between different servers. It gives you scalability but also reliability because you will have more redundancy. And it's usually the preferred way to scale. When splitting into multiple servers, you need to take into consideration if you have a state or not. If you don't have a state, no problem. You can just put different servers and have a load balancer that will direct the traffic to different servers, and that's it. But if you have a state, then you will face the cap theorem. I won't talk about the cap theorem in this video because it's a big topic on itself. So we can simplify the services, for example, making them stateless. But the database or any storage service will need to face the consequences of the cap theorem. As I mentioned before, when we're thinking about horizontal scaling with the state involved, we need to face the cap theorem. And this has certain implications for the database. For example, we need to consider the consistency level that we need to have. Do we need to have a strict consistency? That means that whenever you save, that data is immediately available for everyone. Or can we handle eventual consistency? Basically, that means that when you write, it will take some time for all the clients reading the data to get that right. We also need to think about if we need to read more or write more. So depending on that, we will also take one approach or the other. Horizontal scaling is not something cheap to do. So that's why it's very important to get it as soon as possible when you know that your system will grow beyond certain scale. There are different ways that you can achieve horizontal scaling. For example, you can have a load balancer that will direct the traffic to different servers to optimize the load or performance of the system. In this case, with the load balancer, we assume that all the servers have access to the same data. Then we can also split the data. So in that sense, we can have sharding or partitioning where we split the data between different servers. By splitting the data in multiple servers, you are able to scale each of them independently. Many systems work like this. For example, Flink or Kafka work like this. You can split the data following different approaches. For example, you can do a vertical split by feature, or you can have by value. Let's say we want to split the data between America's user base, Europe, and Asia. Or we can also do it by hash. So for example, by hash, you can imagine a hash table where we get the value that we want to select in which database is going to be stored. In this case, let's say we have a user ID, so we hash it, and we can say that depending on the hash, we will store it in one bucket or the other. In this case, the buckets are the database's servers where it would be. Then you can also scale this by using consistent hashing, but that's a topic for another video. Another thing that we can do with the data is to have replication, where we can have multiple copies of the data in different servers. Replication is very useful when you have read-intensive applications, right? So if you can replicate the data between different nodes, and if you know that you're going to read more, then you can just use those nodes to read, and you can have eventual consistency to update those nodes. Following with this approach, we end up with this architecture. We still have a layer architecture, but we have horizontally scale our system, so we have multiple nodes handling the load and also multiple nodes handling the data. Now millions of users can use our site because we have been able to split the load and the data between different servers. But this came up with some trade-offs. It was expensive and the cap theorem had to be considered. Now that we have multiple servers, instead of having only one, there is more latency between the calls between different servers. So that would be making the system a little bit slower. It's what I mentioned in the first video about sometimes there will be conflicts between some non-functional requirements and others. Users are expecting to have fast responses. We can also save a lot of resources and make tons of money if we're able to serve them faster. Can we be faster? How can we do it? Check out my next video to know more about that. That's it for today. Thank you very much for watching. If you like the video, don't forget to click like and subscribe, and of course, share it with your friends. If you have any doubts or any comments, don't forget to put them in the comment section below. Thank you very much for watching, and see you next time.